Let's go day one. Hashtag box score watching. As a European, you know, it's kind of tough to watch a lot of games. As of right now, since I'm, you know, I have to work somewhere, I have to go to school. But I try my best to watch as much as basketball as I can, because I love it. It's one of my greatest joys, and that's why I make videos. So I figured I would essentially do a recap as to what happened in the day. I will look through the box scores, through the games, through my lens, how it all went, and I'll essentially talk about most of the games from the day, what I took from them, what I learned from them, what I've seen about them, what I've watched, and we'll see how it pans out. This is just the first episode. I'll just try things, I'll just see how it looks, how it works. And first we will obviously start off with the game I actually watched fully, which is the Pelicans against the Nets, which was a game I was, you know, really excited for. So I had time in the morning to watch one of these games today, and I was, you know, thinking about Atlanta maybe, then, you know, Chicago, Miami, Cleveland, Toronto, but I figured I would watch Pelicans Nets, since these two teams in the landscape of things feel like the two most interesting teams that played today, especially when it was against each other. And my takeaways, let's firstly talk about the Pelicans, which they played really well. They played really well. They were ready for the occasion. Brandon Ingram, I thought, was sensational. Just gave him buckets. He looks so smooth out there. His shot looks so smooth. 28 points, 7 rebounds, 5 assists, 4 turnovers. They were lots. They were a little sloppy to the overall throughout the game, but they came out very sloppy. Once they got to, you know, a little bit of a lead in the first quarter, they were sloppy as it gets. They were as sloppy as it gets. And Brandon Ingram was a huge part of that. Zion Williamson played 30 minutes, 25 points, all just bullying Ben Simmons. He was going at him. He was just straight up going to the rim, going at him with a smile on his face. 25, 9, and 3, 4 steals. He looks really good. I'm happy to see Zion healthy, especially the way he was, you know, the way he looked out there. He looked a little slow on defense. He looked a little slow in transition since it is really fully first game back. But it's very promising for Pelicans fans. And the last takeaway is they got a good squad. They got some really good role players. They got some quality shooters out there. They got two big dogs in Brandon Ingram and Zion Williamson. CJ is a great complimentary piece there. There was a moment when the fans out there were chanting, "You need Dame," and CJ McCollum laughed at that. That was an interesting moment from the game, I would say. They still, you know, Jackson Hayes could still play, and he's injured Dyson Daniels. They got an interesting squad, and they could very well beat last year's Grizzlies, and they could sneak into the top four seeds. We'll see. I didn't predict them to, but the first game was very promising, and Brandon Ingram gave me a good points to my fantasy. So, and as for the Brooklyn Nets, KD, he will get his, he will get his buckets, but he was, I don't know, I didn't feel like he was good at all. And I mean, he got 32 points. What do I have to say? He just didn't look Kevin Durant to me. Nick Claxton played pretty decent when you know, think about it. Royce O'Neal was great, bad word for this game, but they weren't the problem. But Kyrie was horrible, bad on defense, didn't shoot well. 34 minutes, 15 points, after he said he wants to be MVP, DPOY, he wants to collect every silverware or whatever he said. I'm pretty sure he said that. And Ben Simmons fouled out. So, yeah, it's a rough start for him. I'm still rooting for Ben to bounce back. I mean, their offense is just so ugly. Their offense is just, you know, Kevin, Kyrie, be great, that's it. Essentially, they don't run much sets. They don't run much, you know, they don't run an offense, essentially. They run pick and rolls, they run ISOs for those two guys, and that's it, essentially. It's just a ugly, ugly offense to watch. They'll be good, but I don't know, man. The Nets just are the Nets, I suppose. Second of all, I watched some of the Hawks-Rockets game. I watched the fourth quarter a little bit, I looked at the highlights. Jalen Green did not shoot particularly well. My friend who's a Hawks fan told me that Jabari Smith looked really good, even though, you know, his stats don't say it. For a rookie, he looked really solid. Even from what I watched, from highlights, he looked solid. He shot a lot of threes, but I mean, if he believes he's good enough to take 11 threes in a game, I mean, why not? They're tanking, essentially. Kevin Porter signed his extension and he looked pretty decent. Alfred Sengun gave us some work. They're rebuilding, but I want to talk about the Hawks mostly. DeAndre Hunter looks very good. He looks improved. He loves his mid-range jumper. You could see it. He took a lot of them. He made a lot of them. He was 10 of 15, obviously, but he looks very solid. John Collins was great to see, especially for my fantasy. He looks very solid. Clint Capella was weird, but they got Onyeka Okongwu, so it doesn't really matter that much. Trae Young didn't shoot well, but he still play makes. He still controls the pace of the game. And DeJounte Murray is a perfect complementary, even though the stats don't show. You know, both of these play pretty solid games, even though their stats are not that great. And DeJounte essentially took over in the fourth quarter, where he was getting a look. He grabbed some steals and basically sealed the game midway through the fourth quarter, and it was just a breeze then for the Hawks. Next on my agenda today, we go through Orlando Detroit, where, you know, this year's number one pick against last year's number one pick, and Paolo Banchero looked absolutely incredible. First player since LeBron James to have 25, 5, and 5 on opening night, which is pretty insane. He just looks great. He looks NBA ready. He looked NBA ready from the start. He just looks great. My other takeaway was Jalen Suggs looks really good. He looked really good out there. I mean, he's not gonna shoot like this every game, obviously, but if he's gonna have this approach and take care of the ball a little more, as you know, whole Orlando team should, as you see, they had a lot of turnovers. Jalen Suggs is an elite defender already, and if he is just a plus on offense, it's really great for them. I don't understand why Caleb Houston played this many minutes, but I guess. And they were also missing Cole Anthony, which is a bummer for them, but they probably want to tank also. As for the Pistons, Bojan Bogdanovic, the acquisition from the Utah Jazz, was sensational. He knocked down six threes. Cade didn't shoot well, but he still looked pretty decent. And Jaden Ivey, my goodness, he started off very sloppy from what I've seen. And then he just turned it up, played really well, 19 points, great debut. And Jalen Duren also, essentially, very good debut, 14 and 10. That's all they really want from anyone. Detroit, you know, they probably want to tank also, but they also said they want to make the playoffs. I have them around the play-in. And this is a promising start. As for Washington Indy, I didn't watch a peek of this. Let me look at the box score. I know Kyle Kuzma had some really good fantasy game for me, since he had like a 30-point fantasy game, so that's really nice for me. Bradley Beal. It was Bradley Beal, I suppose. Monte Morris was a plus. Daniel Dia. Let's see, how was Tyrese playing? 26, 4 and 7. Mean minus 5. Question is, will they trade Buddy Hield, obviously. Miles Turner didn't play. Like, this game is just not that interesting in the grand scheme of things. Then, DeMar DeRozan was sensational. He continues his MVP form from last year. He's such a smooth player. 37, 6 and 9 without Zach LaVine on the road against Miami. Secures the dub for the Chicago Bulls, who last season didn't beat a good team ever. It feels like they won, you know, one playoff game against the Bucks, but in the regular season they didn't beat anybody good. And DeMar was carrying with Ayo Dosunmu, who I'm really high on also, who played sensational from what I've seen. I watched the fourth quarter, I watched the highlights. They look pretty decent. Patrick Williams took six shots, 4 points. Interesting to see how his season will progress. Andre Drummond, I mean, this was a weird box score to look at, but DeMar DeRozan was sensational. Look at his highlights from today. Oh man, he was sensational. As for the Miami, Max Strus was a sensational. Tyler Hero had minus 18, which was seen since he didn't close the game, I feel like. And from highlights, he looked literally lost on defense. And in the fourth quarter, I don't remember seeing him, so I'm pretty sure he didn't close the game. Even though, you know, on offense, he was actually pretty sensational when you look at his stats. But Max Strus was the real sensational player from them. Jimmy Butler, 16 free throws. Just an ugly game for Miami. Bam Adebayo at least shot those 15 shots, but didn't make a whole lot of them. But still probably more encouraging to see him actually shoot those shots than rather than, you know, doing essentially nothing. But hopefully for them he'll get better. But the Heat just seem a little weird. And Kyle Lowry, 2 points, we'll not talk about that. I believe they'll get better, obviously. They'll, you know, they'll just make the playoffs. They just what they do. But if I'm Pat Riley, I'm slightly concerned about this team. Then I watched the fourth quarter of Cleveland against Toronto. And Donovan Mitchell was sensational. I learned that Darius Garland unfortunately had to leave the game with a left eye injury, even though he clearly wasn't playing that well. But for Cleveland, the most important thing, Donovan Mitchell looked sensational. 31-9, he was sensational, especially after Garland left. They showed the statistics that he had like 2 points in the first quarter and 29 then, since then. Yeah, Cherry Osman was pretty decent from the bench. I still feel like they need somebody else on the bench. They just need one like sharpshooter. Cherry was, he was very good from the 3-point line, but they need a sharpshooter. They need one shooter really, and they just don't have it right now. And hopefully Darius Garland is fine. I didn't see the injury report about him. Since it's a left eye injury, I hope he's not out long, and he shouldn't probably be with a left eye injury. But we'll see. But they'll be fine. And Toronto was sensational on defense in the fourth quarter. They just locked the Cavs down. It was very sloppy also from the Cavs, but they locked them down. The refs played some part. There was a lot of free throws. It was a sloppy fourth quarter. Still a fun watch. They got it done. Scottie 15 points. Pascal 23-11, even though, you know, they made him work also. I hope for my sake that Fred VanVleet has a better game than today, but it was still pretty good since he had 4 steals. But, you know, for my fantasy, I need a little more to be sure. But, I mean, it's not a bad game and they won, which is really great for Toronto and not that great for my, you know, early season predictions. Then Ja Morant, sensational against the Knicks. Cam Reddish actually had a resurgence in a way. 22 points, 9 of 15, even though he shot a very stupid 3-pointer in overtime. That when it was, they were down 3 at like 40 seconds, and it was just ugly 3-pointer. Airballed it, even though they said the rookie from Memphis got a piece from it. I'm not sure how his name is, and I will look it up, look at it as soon as we get to Memphis' box score. Julius Randle played really good. RJ Barrett was just awful. Even though he defended well, but, you know, this is unacceptable. He needs to be better on offense, as if this Knicks squad wants to do anything, essentially. And Jalen Brunson, even though the stats are not pretty, 15-6-9 is not bad, and he was pretty good in the fourth quarter and overtime. Quite unlucky to not, you know, make some shots there. He went one in and out from the three-point line. A layup that could have gone in. Just some unluck there for the Knicks. Isaiah Hartenstein is a great addition. We all knew that. He was very good. And as for Memphis, Desmond Bane had to leave the game and he was not playing well, but it's, you know, well, he was not shooting well. He was still playing pretty alright. But it's a concern. I don't know, man. They just seem pretty injured already. And with just playstyle, even though he was sensational, took 6 threes, made 3 of them, which is perfect for him, made his free throws most of the time, got to his spots as he always does in the clutch. They run the same play basically every damn time, and it works perfectly because Jai is just that fast. You know, it's pretty unpredictable what he can do, but when you watch their games and last year's games, they always do the same stuff, which is funny to see, but maybe some teams will pick up on it, maybe they won't. Yeah, and Cha was just great. As for OKC against the Timberwolves, T-Wolves won. Rudy Gobert was sensational. I didn't watch much of it. I saw, you know, some highlights, but Rudy Gobert was sensational. He had 23 points, 16 rebounds, which was perfect for my fantasy. I just won my debt. D'Angelo Russell was pretty good shooting-wise. I couldn't care less about this game, really. That'll be a good team. And Ant-Man and Karl Anthony Towns will not have that many games like this, I hope, for their sake, because otherwise they won't be that good. Which, when you look at it this way, it's pretty sensational that they won this game with how these two played. Shea was Shea. I love me some Shea. I'm happy that he's playing, even though we all know that OKC wants to tank as always. But it's great to see Shea play. 32 points. I watched his highlights. It's always fun to watch him. And Lu Dort needs to be better for my fantasy. That's for sure. Charlotte San Antonio. I mean, does anyone really care about that? No, I don't think so. The Nuggets surprisingly got destroyed by Utah in Utah, and their defense was atrocious. You know, which was an obvious concern since Michael Porter Jr. was never known as a defender. Nikola Jokic is still picked on defense in the playoffs, even though he's been much better in the regular season. But Colin Sexton just ran at him. He just went at him. Van at him, van at him, van at him, they all went at him. Even though he had 27, 6 and 4, 4 and 6, and he shot 70% from the field, they just ran at him on offense. And at Jamal Murray and at Michael Porter Jr. And it was ugly. It was very ugly. And not the start that Denver wanted to see, and I didn't want to see, because I thought they would be a great regular season team, which they still probably will be, but not an encouraging start for their season. They play the Warriors next. We'll see how they play against the Warriors on Friday. On Friday, yes. And Utah, I mean, they're rebuilding. Colin Sexton, Lauri Markkanen. They should keep these two, Sexton and Markkanen, and just get rid of everyone else, essentially. I feel like maybe THT they should keep since he's not that good and he's young. Nickey Alexander-Walker, Oche Agbaji, they should play all of these guys. Walker Kessler, you know, that's the rookie, also he had 12 points, 10 rebounds, that's great to see. But they should trade as many players as they can. Kelly Olynyk should go, Jared Vanderbilt should go, Jordan Clarkson should go, Mike Conley should go, Rudy Gay should go, Malik Beasley should go, and just embrace the tank. Even though I appreciate them not, you know, just giving up instantly. Then, the best matchup, you know, of the later slate of games was the Dallas Mavericks and the Phoenix Suns, as you know, Dallas at Phoenix, and after what happened in, you know, game 7 last season, the Suns offseason was very weird, and it felt like they were gonna get their asses kicked, but Mavericks got too overconfident, too cocky. They played a lot of ISO ball that worked for them, didn't work late, and they lost the lead, and the Suns came back, which is encouraging for them. Chris Paul was absolutely atrocious. I can't stand Chris Paul, and it feels like he can't stand himself right now. Also, he was benched for Damian Lee, who was the hero essentially for the Suns. He hit some incredible shots, even though he was picked on, but on defense, he's essentially saved them. Devin Booker was great, and I feel like, you know, Chris Paul had his value, had his time, and he'll probably play good after I say this, but I feel like they would be much better off without him at this point. Let Devin Booker play the essential point guard of the team. If they had somebody at 30 million, I think Chris Paul makes like 30 million a year right now. If they had a wing or a, you know, two guard, another like 6'6" guard that makes 30 million a year instead of Chris Paul, that's a shooter, or just a good defender, they would be much better off than Chris Paul, I feel like. But we'll see how their season goes. It's great for them that they got back at the Mavs, you know, winners work, maybe, as they say. And the Mavs just got too cocky. They'll be fine. They'll make the playoffs. They'll be fine. Christian Wood had 16 straight points in a row in the fourth quarter. He was laying wood on him as the commentator. And yeah, that's it about this game, I guess. And Portland, Sacramento. Portland won. I've heard Dame was not that great. Yeah, he was 5 of 18, 20 points, 8 assists. Anthony Simons was better a little bit. Jeremy Grant. When they went to him as center, I heard they turned it around, turned the game around, and it's a kind of horrible loss for the Kings. But you know, 23 points from Herder, 33 points from Fox. Sabonis is just 13, but you know, they need to win these games if they, you know, as against they essentially their closest foes, in the Portland Trail Blazers. for the playing spot. Yeah. So that's it for today's slate of games. Tomorrow we just got two banger games with Milwaukee against Philly and Clippers Lakers. And as for my top three players of the day, Brandon Ingram out there, he was sensational. He looks like an all-star, perennial all-star, superstar, however you want to call it. He is sensational. Paolo Banchero for his debut, incredible. I could have put Ja Morant here, but I feel like, you know, we gotta put some light on these players. Even though most of the people will know, Damian Lee gets some honorable mention for today. Kuzma for carrying my fantasy, Rudy Gobert for carrying my fantasy, and DeMar was sensational. DeMar was the best player tonight. 37, 6 and 9. Starting of where he left off last season. We'll see how the Bulls fare in the season, but it's great to see. I love DeMar's game. And just love to see him succeed. Like and subscribe. And I'll see y'all tomorrow for another Bucks Score Watching Day. Do 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 do.